I've had a lot of folks ask, and yes, we are all well now. We had a good trip to Florida. We had a good trip to Baton Rouge for the holiday. We had a good trip to Florida. If you decide to go to Orlando, I would recommend not doing it on New Year's Eve because it's really crowded. And then we got to the conference. The conference was really good. There were some good classes, some excellent speakers, some good experiences that I hope will be of benefit to the youth group and certainly to College Hill as well. I'm not going to share much of that with you, but don't be too jealous of the hotel by the ocean, because I went out there the first night. Somebody said, is the ocean cold? I didn't know. I was numb before I got to the water. There was a bad cold snap. And then gradually through the conference, at any given time, 1 to 3 members of our family was sick at our stomachs. So we had a beautiful view of the ocean that was out the window while we were in the hotel room throwing up. It was awesome. Yeah, there you go. So that's what it is. But we're all better now. Okay. Oh. Knock, knock. Thank you. Banana? Knock, knock. Banana? Knock, knock. Banana.
Banana.
Knock, knock.
There. Orange.
Orange. Orange, you glad I didn't say banana, right? Okay. Is anybody experiencing that joke for the first time tonight? Okay, a couple of people. I'm actually amazed at that. I had assumed falsely that everybody would know that joke. I can remember as a child, knock, knock, who's there, banana, banana, who, 5, 10, 15 minutes, we just keep going and going and going and going, and finally get to the orange, you glad I didn't say banana, rolling on the floor laughing, that's so funny. It's great when you get to experience that with small children. Sam and Rebecca thinks that's hilarious, but they don't quite get the concept of knock, knock jokes, because she'll go, you know, banana, banana, who, pumpkin. It's a pun. Three-year-olds don't get puns. Pumpkin who? Pumpkin orange! Ah! Lots of fun. They really, really get a kick out of that. If you ever want to mess with a kid, actually you can do this with adults too. Well, I know a great knock-knock joke, but you have to start it. Who's there? It starts to filter through as people get it. That's all there is. The other person's going to... Another one that's great to mess with people, knock-knock. Control freak. Wait, now you say control freak who? I have a theory that control freaks don't get that joke, based on my experiences with the people that I've told it to. But there you go. One more. Knock, knock. Howl. Howl, you know, unless you open the door. All right. There. Okay. All right. That one. I got a pass on that one. Oh, I forgot I had little slides for it. Well, that's silly. And preserved forever now on YouTube. Great. Okay. This is kind of an interesting question. Who's there? I don't know where knock-knock jokes came from, where they started. I know there's kind of a knock-knock joke in Shakespeare. One of the first plays I ever got to do was Taming of the Shrew, and there's a scene where the protagonist, Petruchio, comes to his friend's house, and he tells his servant, Grumio, he said, "Knock me here, I say." And he says... Yeah, knock, I say. And Grumio says, "Knock, sir, whom should I knock? Is there anyone that has abused your worship?" And he says, "Villain, I say, knock me here soundly." He's trying to get him to knock on the gate. He's like, "Knock you, sir? Who am I, sir, that I should knock you, sir?" He just totally puns left and right, even back in Elizabethan England, going for it. Did anybody see the TV skit where the lady's sitting in her apartment by herself and there's a knock on the door and she says, "Who's here? Who's there?" And, "Plumber. I didn't ask for a plumber. Candy Graham. Da, 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 da. You're that land shark, aren't you?" "Oh, I'm not a land shark. I'm a dolphin." "Oh, well, that's okay." And she opens the door and the shark comes in and gets her. I don't know where you come up with stuff like that. And how many times have you seen in a movie or in a TV show where somebody knocks on the door and the person opens the door and they're so shocked at who it is, they just slam the door in their face and run away? Not scared, just amazed. That's in the Bible. Sort of. Turn over to Acts chapter 12. There's a couple of things in the Bible that I don't know if they were intended to be funny that I find amusing. I find it amusing that John, in his gospel, says three times that I outran Peter. When he's talking about going to the tomb, when they got word that Jesus was alive, he says like three different times, I got there before Peter did. It's like, we got it. You got there first. And here you've got this moment in Acts chapter 12. Peter's in prison. The believers are praying for him. He's in prison. And there's an earthquake. I might have misspoke. Anyway, angel of the Lord appears to him in verse 7, struck Peter on the side and woke him up. Get up! And the chains fell off Peter's wrists. The angel says, put your clothes and your sandals on. Peter did so. Wrap your cloak around you and follow me, the angel told him. Peter follows him out of prison, and it says that he had no idea that this was really happening. He thought he was having a vision. And the angel leads him all the way out, and suddenly, you know, finally it sinks in on him that this is actually happening. Verse 11, Peter came to himself and said, now I know without a doubt that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were hoping would happen. And when this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Peter knocks on the door, knock, knock. Rhoda comes to the door. Who's there? It's Peter. And it says when she heard his voice, she just runs back without even letting him in. I think that's funny. I mean, it's just a funny moment to me. Knock, knock. She recognized Peter's voice. She's overjoyed, runs back. Peter's at the door. And it gets even better. Verse 15, you're out of your mind, they told her. And she kept insisting that it was so. They said, it must be his angel. We've been praying for him that he'd be okay, but obviously he's dead now, and it's his angel knocking at the door. There's some moments of extreme faith that happen in the book of Acts, but in this moment, it's like they've already given up. But he keeps knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. And this is just this great moment. He's knocking at the door. Who's there? I know who it is. I didn't even let him in. Like, can you imagine being Peter? You've had an angel rescue you from prison, and they won't let you in. Hey, guys. Who's at the door? This is a question that kind of informs how you react. Think about when you're at home and somebody comes to your door and knocks. If you're anything like me, who's at the door makes all the difference in terms of how I'm going to react to it. Sometimes it's expected. Sometimes I'm waiting for somebody, and sometimes it's completely unexpected. And certainly that influences how I feel about it. But if I'm at home and I'm watching a television show or eating dinner with my family and someone knocks at the door, who's there? It's pretty important. I don't know that we have beggars that come to the doors the way they might have had in other times. I've certainly had people approach me who didn't know me out on the street and ask for help. But I can't remember a time when someone's come to my door that I didn't know and said, will you give me some money or give me some food? But we certainly have salespeople, right, that come door to door. I've had magazine offers, siding, windows, all kinds of interesting things where people come, knock on the door. Nowadays, depending on where you are and how far they've gotten, you might have someone knocking on your door wanting to buy your mineral rights. All sorts of interesting things. People wanting to sell you products. Maybe they don't want to sell you a thing. Maybe they want to sell you an idea, get you to sign up for a political movement or a process like that, or maybe a religious idea. And when someone's coming to my door unsolicited, I want to be gracious. I want to be Christ-like. But when someone's coming to my door to try to sell me something, I'm not too excited to see him most of the time. What about the police? We've had the police come unexpectedly to our door on a couple of occasions. That's exciting. We have an alarm system that has a panic button on it. And depending on how that is set off, the alarm company in some instances will call us and say, are you okay? And in some instances, they'll just call the police, depending on how that goes off. We have these little fun little remote controls that if you have a toddler in the house and they like to push buttons and they get a hold of it, they might set that off for you. So we're at home one day and The alarm suddenly goes off. We find a stunned Rebecca standing in the hallway with the remote control. We get everything turned off. We're settled down. Bang, 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 bang on the door. Police is there, but right then I'm happy to see him. I mean, I think Robert was being very honest on Sunday when he talked about you're driving down the street and you see a policeman on the side of there. I check my speed. Even if I'm not speeding, I instinctively check my speed to make sure I'm not speeding. But when you want them there, you really want them there. And they were very kind and polite. They offered to come inside. Well, they asked if they could come inside and make sure we were okay, and we said sure. And that was great. Happened another time while we were in the backyard, and the nice policeman gave Sam a sticker. I was very glad he did that instead of arresting me or something like that. And one evening, somebody in the neighborhood had made a call, and for some reason, they came to our house, and we were fine. But what if it's the police at the door? Depends what's going on. Maybe it's the delivery guy. More and more, we're ordering things online. So when I'm back in the room watching television, my front door's in another room, and there's a knock on the door, and I might be kind of, why do I have to, I don't know who it is. Oh, it's the delivery guy. It's this thing that I want. Then I'm happy that he's there. I'm kind of happy for the knock on the door in those moments. And then there's family, friends, acquaintances. And let's be honest, sometimes that can be happy or not, depending on who's coming over and what they want to do. Present company is completely great, Jim. We're good on family in that regard. I'm always happy to see my wonderful in-laws. And that is recorded forever on YouTube. But even if they're coming over and I'm excited to see them, usually in the back of the head, it's, okay, I'm glad they're here. We're going to enjoy this visit. But I know at some point I'm going to get back to my regular life, to my routine, and that's okay. What if you got a knock on the door and it was those folks? The prize patrol. We actually had a moment. This is not where we won money, so don't ask me for anything. You can if you need to. We actually had a moment in our collective life where we were trying to plan an extended family event. And one of the family members ruled out the date we were looking for because she insisted that she had to be home in case the prize patrol came to her house. I don't know what the regulations are. I don't know if they knock on your door and if you're not home, they just go to the next person on the list or something. But I thought that was hilarious. It was irritating, but it was hilarious too. What if it was some nobility? Maybe this is lost on us because we don't have the royal family in America. But I was trying to think, what are the kinds of people that would engender that same response of, oh my goodness, there is a prince at my door, or the queen mother is at my door. How am I going to respond to this? Maybe there's a celebrity. I know Albert's not around anymore, but maybe there's somebody that you really want to meet, a Nobel Prize winner, an athlete, an actor. I wanted to put some pictures up, but I didn't want to give anybody any advertising, so we'll just go with a question mark. I don't think it's bad to have people that you admire, people that you would be excited to meet. What would that be like if you were at home, expected or even unexpected, and you get the knock on the door and you go and check the door, and it's that person? You ever seen those episodes of Oprah where she surprises someone and they just burst into tears? Man, I hope I wouldn't react like that. That would be embarrassing. Just, I can't believe you're here. Doesn't that change how we receive them? I mean, if you open the door and the prize patrol is there, that's going to be a completely different experience than someone who's wanting to sell you a subscription to something. Completely different experience. Completely different way that we're going to react to those people. And if it was one of these folks, someone who's bringing you something, someone that you desperately want to meet, who's coming to your house and knocking on the door, can you imagine meeting that individual, those people, and saying, oh, hey, the game's on. I'm going to come back out in a little while if you want to hang out. If not, that's okay. It'd be absurd. Can you imagine bringing them into the house and kind of ignoring them? Saying, you know, make yourself comfortable, have a seat. I'm doing this other thing. I think there is perfectly reasonable amount of falling over ourselves that would happen if an honored guest came to your house and how we would react to that. Jesus says in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. Knock, knock. Who's there? It's Jesus. But this isn't a joke. It's not a pun. It's something that he says. I stand at the door and I knock. And if you'll open the door, I'll come in and I'll eat with you. Can I suggest that how we respond to Jesus' knocking at the door is going to be directly influenced by how we perceive Jesus? By that question, who's there? Jesus who? Not that we don't have an idea of who Jesus is. Certainly not that he doesn't know who he is. But how we see him. Do we see Jesus knocking on the door as an interruption in what we'd rather be doing? I'm getting the knock. This isn't a good time. I'm going to answer the door. I'm going to try to deal with it as quickly as I can because it's throwing off what I want to be doing right now. I would really rather be... Do we see him in the same light as we might a policeman when we hear the knock? Is it, I don't want to get caught? Or, I'm glad you're here if I'm scared. Can you check the house and then leave me alone? Do we react to him the same way we might to a salesman? Or to a fundraiser? I know you want something from me. I'll give you what I have to give you so we can finish this transaction and be done. And there's kind of a theme. Can you feel the theme that's running through there? Or maybe even in a happy light, we might see him as a delivery guy, as the guy who's going to show up and give us what we've asked for, grant the things that we've ordered. But again, how often, when was the last time you asked the UPS or the FedEx guy to come in and sit down and have a cup of coffee? I'm not saying that the way, it just wouldn't feel normal, but try it. You know, they'll probably say no, but give it a shot. See what happens. Let me know if you do. Or maybe we're even fond of Jesus, the same way we are of a distant family member or of a friend. And we look forward to the visit. And we enjoy the time when we're together. But in the back of our minds, we're thinking, I'm waiting for this to pass so I can get back to my routine. This is a great visit. But I know it's only for a little bit, and then I'm going to get back to what I was going to be doing anyway. Do we ever see him as a beggar? I love the songs that we were singing tonight. Jim, I appreciate the thought you put in. Every one of those songs just went right towards this passage, this idea of Jesus extending us this invitation. And I don't think it's built into the songs, but I think we can hear the songs and think of it that way. We talk about Jesus, are you not weary waiting for me? You're standing out there all through the long night, weary, knocking again as he... I hope that doesn't give us this image that Jesus is out in the cold asking, please let me in. That he's dependent on us in some way. You know, hoping that we will only accept him, if only we'll let him in. I mean, that we will accept him. Because if we think about Jesus in that way, I don't think we're looking through the peephole to see who's really at the door. I don't think we're paying attention to who's actually there. How does Jesus present himself? Turn with me to Revelation chapter 1. Verse 9. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see, and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me, and then it just gets interesting. And when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun, shining in all its brilliance. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Who's at the door? Who's knocking at the door? Because it's not someone that's just begging, please let me in from the cold. Now, this is my opinion. I think some of the way that John explains things is because he's trying to explain a reality that we haven't experienced yet. I heard a speaker one time say, if a baby in utero had language, and you were talking to the baby and trying to explain the world to them, how would you explain things if they've never seen anything? John's trying to describe a reality that's beyond what we're used to. So I think he's having to use pictures and images. His feet were like burning bronze in a furnace to create these vivid and amazing pictures. And you start to try to create this picture in your mind of who Jesus is in this glorified state. Turn over to Revelation 19. Verse 11. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and makes war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Who's at the door? Who's at the door? This reality of who Jesus is just flies in the face of all of these other misconceptions about him. It flies into this idea that I've got to put up with this intrusion, because if that's who's at the door and who's knocking, it beats the prize patrol. You know, it beats all these other things that we talk about, and certainly all of these bad perceptions. We, or at least I, have a recurring idea that this image of Jesus standing at the door and knocking is the moment of salvation, if you will. He's knocking, I open the door and I accept him. I am baptized, like he said his followers needed to do, and he becomes the Lord of my life. Not that he wasn't already the Lord, not that he isn't already everything he describes, but I become his follower, his disciple, his willing slave. And he comes in and we eat together. He cleans up my house and fills it with his presence. And I think that is a good representation of repentance and salvation. But who's he writing to? Who's he writing to? He's not right here in this passage that we read from, Revelation 3 and verse 20, when he says, I stand at the door and knock, he's not writing to people that haven't believed. He's not writing to people that aren't already his followers. In Ephesians 5, we know this image that Paul creates, where he compares the church and Christ to a relationship, a marriage relationship. And he draws that comparison. And we could take it in places that I don't know that Paul intended, but I don't think it's an injustice. Do you ever take your spouse for granted? I get busy. And it's not any kind of antagonistic thing. It's not that I look down on my wife. It's not that I don't appreciate her. It's that I just sort of take her for granted. And then you have these moments. I get these moments of clarity when I remember how blessed I am to be married to such a wonderful woman. Rediscover that joy, that love, that relationship. I think we get the same thing going on with the bride, us as the bride of Christ as his church, and with Jesus as the groom of the church. He's talking to the church. He's talking to people that have accepted him. What does he have to say to them? Let's read this one more time. Starting in verse 14 of chapter 3. To the angel of the church in Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Jesus spoke during his ministry about laying up for ourselves treasures in heaven. I wonder if he's speaking to the church here that is stopped doing that. As I understand it, Laodicea was famous for making medicines and because of that was wealthy. And the wealth had kind of become their identity, become of who they were. And even though they had money, they'd become poor in terms of treasures in heaven. And this idea of needing to cover up their nakedness, it's like paupers in heaven. Beggars in heaven. Can you imagine being in heaven where you've anticipated going through your physical life and realizing that you just haven't laid up much treasure there? Who's there? Jesus, who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. Chapter 2, verses 4 and 5, he's talking to the church in Ephesus. Yet I hold this against you, you've forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. And I wonder what it looks like when a church has its lampstand removed. I wonder if you end up with a shell of a church that's going through the motions. A church that hears Jesus knock and just ignores him or fails to recognize who it is. Or maybe like we've described, just takes him for granted. A church that's content to stay comfortable in her own traditions or preconceived ideas or man-made stipulations while ignoring the call of her Lord and Savior. And I ask, is he saying this to the church today? Is he saying these words to the church in America? Is he saying this to the church in Texas? Is he saying this to the church in North Richland Hills? Is he saying this to us? To me? To you? If Jesus is saying this to us, well, it's a challenge. You've forgotten your first love. You're not laying up treasure where it needs to be. But the good news about it is that he's saying it because he loves us. And the knock on the door isn't yet a missed opportunity. Verse 19, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. Who? Those who I love, I rebuke and discipline. So it may not be a pleasant thing to be sitting and hearing Jesus say something about how we're off the mark, but he's saying, I'm doing it because I love you. And if I love you, I will rebuke you and discipline you because I care about what happens to you. Isn't that a fun thing to try to explain to a child? I'm not getting on to you because I hate you, believe it or not, but because I care about you. If I didn't care, then I wouldn't care. But those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with them and they with me. Remember, he's saying this to people that have already committed to him. He's not saying this to someone who hasn't converted yet. He's saying this to people that are already believers. And it's a two-way street. I mean, he says in the Sermon on the Mount, he says in Luke chapter 11, verse 10, everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. In Jeremiah 29, 13, the Lord says, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. And I want you to think about this, and I want it to be personal. And we may need to think in terms of what's wrong in our lives, what we need to change, but I want you to think even more basically about it. Who's there? Who's at the door? The living one. Jesus is knocking. Are we seeing who is at the door? Are we seeing who he is? I want to read you a quote because it hits it on the nail so well. I don't think I could do better unless I plagiarized it and pretend I wrote it. Jesus answers for all time the question of whom we are to worship. You shall worship the Lord your God, and in him only shall you serve. Matthew 4:10. The one true God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God whom Jesus Christ revealed. God made clear his hatred for all idolatries by placing an incisive command at the start of the Ten Commandments, "You shall have no other gods before me," Exodus 23. Nor does idolatry consist only in bowing before visible objects of adoration. The essence of idolatry is the entertainment of thoughts about God that are unworthy of him. To think rightly about God is, in an important sense, to have everything right. To think wrongly about God is, in an important sense, to have everything wrong. We desperately need to see who God is. To read about his self-disclosure to the ancient people Israel. To meditate on his attributes. To gaze upon the revelation of his nature in Jesus Christ. When we see the Lord of hosts high and lifted up, ponder his infinite wisdom and knowledge, wonder at his unfathomable mercy and love, we cannot help but move into worship. To see who the Lord is brings us to confession. When Isaiah caught sight of the glory of God, he cried, "Woe is me, for I am lost. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Isaiah 6, verse 5. The pervasive sinfulness of human beings becomes evident when contrasted with the radiant holiness of God. Our fickleness becomes apparent once we see God's faithfulness. To understand his grace is to understand our guilt. We worship the Lord not only because of who he is, but also because of what he has done. Above all, the God of the Bible is the God who acts. His goodness, faithfulness, justice, mercy, all can be seen in his dealings with his people. His gracious actions are not only etched into ancient history, but are engraved into our personal histories. As the Apostle Paul says, the only reasonable response is to worship. Romans 12, verse 1. We praise God for who he is and thank him for what he has done. Who's at the door? Who's there? Jesus, the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. Jesus is knocking. Are we looking at him and seeing who he is? And do we realize the opportunity we have to enjoy the kind of fellowship he describes? Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with them, and they with me. To those who are victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. If you have ears, listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. Please think about what Jesus is saying. Please think about it as you go home. Please talk about it along the way, when you go to bed and when you get up. If the Word of God is weighing heavily on you tonight, and if you want to respond to the knock of Jesus tonight, whether by putting him on in baptism, repenting of a way in which your life has gone awry, or if you just need strength and encouragement and we can help you, we invite you to come while we stand and while we sing.